Hello again, I'm Joe Stevens.
And I am LTT Moose.
And we're with the Equestrian Inquirer and Everfree Network here at
Las
Vegas.
Are we still? We haven't been fired yet?
We have not been fired yet.
Oh, wow, well, okay. Job security.
We got signed to do the wrapping agency.
That's right,
for
Saint
Vincent.
Yeah, we got a record deal.
We're
going
to go on tour. We're
going
to go
double platinum with that, man.
We're going to go double D platinum.
Double D platinum.
And we are here.
I don't know how I'm going to...
We expect you to put on on an entire musical, basically.
Not talking about us. We're not talking about us here, LTT Moose. We're talking to Sabrina Alberghetti. You know her as Sibsy.
I think so.
Sibsy, the illustrious, illustrative storyboard artist.
And very tired.
Storyboard artist.
This interview is starting off great. Yeah, I'm so tired.
But it's okay. We have a security plank.
We do.
We're good to go. And so... Season three
is done.
In the bag. It's great.
It's been done for a while for me, but
right.
It's now done officially. Exactly. So
now all the feedback is coming in.
Yes, it is.
And we're loving it. And the episodes that you did in season three, you know, you did quite a lot in season two, but in season three were?
I did Too Many Pinkie Pies and Apple Family Reunion, and then I helped out on the finale because it was such a big,
there was a lot visually going on, right?
And it takes a long time to do songs for the show, and they needed an extra hand with cleanup, and it happens, so we all kind of powwow together.
We need Sibsy. Bring me Sibsy!
I demand the funnies.
I'm just happy because they kept me working for a little bit longer.
And so, well, let's start off with Too Many Pinkie Pies, then. That was a episode that came off right off the premiere. The premiere has the big publicity and everything, and then you have the second. It almost feels like the second episode of the season, but it was a fantastic episode.
Thanks. And it was my first Pinkie Pie episode, so I
really
was, like real Pinkie Pie episode. So I was excited, but nervous because she's got like there's like a fine line with Pinkie Pie. I find that. You know,
you can't go too insane.
No, because then you'll just hate her.
But that should also give you an opportunity because she's the one with wild takes. She's the most cartoony, I think, of the ponies.
We're allowed to do whatever we want with her for the most part, as you could probably have told from that episode. So.
There were so many visual gags and physics-defying instances, and I think that what you were saying, we can do whatever we want. I think one in particular, and I think it's a notorious scene from that, where she jumps into the air and slams down and then... descends into that. Was that in the script or was that you guys?
No, that was me.
That was you. That was you. So thank you. Yeah. The internet thanks you.
She was trying to be, you know, considerate of her friends. Yeah.
But the amount of distortion that you were able to get with that character, I mean, she's blowing up to, you know, gigantic proportions, you know, that type of thing.
They used like every Pinkie Pie like flash rig we had already, just threw them all in the show. Like,
we have a big blender of flash rigs. Just throw them in there.
Probably crashed the program a few hundred times.
They need to bring in the quantum computing for this one.
Yeah, there's actually a lot of funny gags cut out of that episode for time.
Right.
A lot of stuff that I did.
Any one in particular you're most sad to see go?
Oh, yes. I'm pretty sure it was still in the show where Fluttershy is complaining about how she ruined the picnic, and we did see that one. And then Rarity was complaining about how she ruined her sweet shop or something, and that actually happened. Like, I had actually boarded that sequence out, and it was hilarious because the Pinkies came by and trashed Rarity's shop, and Rarity's like, "How dare you do that?" She's like, "I'm going to go ruin your sweet shop." So Rarity goes over and tries to push the sweet shop over, and Tabitha did such an amazing job with the voice.
So there's
she was neighing like a horse, like straining, trying to push. And I'm sitting at my desk listening to the voice track going, "Oh my God, this is the funniest thing ever."
So there's an unaired but recorded piece where
not animated, it's a storyboard. And then Rarity's trying to push the sweet shop down, and then all the Pinkies just come anyway and just bring it to the ground.
Just destroy it themselves.
So at that point, it doesn't matter. There's a few little things. There was a little bit of more stuff before while they were invading the town. I know there was like a scene where they were coming into Ponyville.
The horror of them flooding in there.
There was a few more of those, some gags in there, but it's just time. There's no time to do it. You know,
right,
22
right.
minutes, so we have to make sure.
We really have to push for an hour-long series now.
an hour long of Pinkie Pie. I don't know.
And then at the very end, it's almost like you have a lot of visual gags, and at the very end, we're like, whatever we had left over, throw them in at the very end because we had to get rid of all these silly looking Pinkie Pies from the G2 and G1 look. Yeah. You know,
where did that come from? The old style pony.
Okay, we've been trying to do that since season one. We've been trying to do it, but it just never. There was never a place for it, and we're like, well, it's not technically really Pinkie Pie, so maybe we're gonna. And as soon as we heard that line, we're like, okay, this is the perfect opportunity, but let's just try it.
So in the script, it says, she says, "Have you ever seen a face as weird as this?" But we don't know what that face looks like.
No,
in the script.
It could have just been her making a goofy face, like, you know, just pulling her cheeks up or something.
Doing the Joker smile, yeah.
Yeah, the typical cartoon. But I was like, we gotta try and do this because it's hilarious. And we got it through the animatic stage, so we're all like high fives. We're like, yeah. Like phase one, we got it through, and then
almost like a subversive type of thing that you're doing there.
Yeah, it was like a little, you know, a happy moment, and then okay, it's probably gonna get pulled when it goes to color because it's gonna be so much more obvious, and then that got through, and we were like, yeah.
And it's almost like the hub hasn't really embraced it because I've seen promos for it. They've been promoting it.
Oh, have they?
Yes, they've been
using it for their commercials. Yeah,
I don't get the hub, so I don't know.
So the scariness was. They embraced it and everyone loves it. It's a really cool throwback.
I don't know. I thought it was so ridiculous. But it was so good.
But ridiculous in such an awesome way and such a nod to the fandom, you know.
Yeah, my partner Dave on that episode did so many hilarious gags with the crowd scene. He did the crowd scene where it's like, she's like, I'm the real Pinkie Pie. No, I'm the real Pinkie Pie. And like,
did the real Pinkie Pie stand up?
Please stand up.
Yeah. Well, he had one.
I'm the real Pinkie.
He had one gag
Pinkie.
That never went through, where it was so bizarre, even on the storyboard, where it was like a background pony, and he, it was like the front of his face, and then he turned his head, and then Pinkie's head was like.
Oh my God!
Oh no!
Like, this is not gonna go through.
This is the second time conjoined twins have come up in a question and interview.
Oh, my God, really?
Yeah. Oh, you should have heard. Yeah, the Double D story.
Sam Vincent's theory on Double D having a conjoined twin on his head, and that's why Double
gross.
D had his head hidden. Was that true, by the way?
As
the storyboard artist for that show, was that what it really was?
No.
Anyway, so.
Oh, and the hands, too.
And the hands. Yes, the hands!
Fingers.
The hands. So gross. And so good.
That was brilliant. Well, you know.
I freaked right out when I saw that. I was like, wait, where did she? Oh, my God. No.
So good.
That. So you are responsible for all the visual gags. And also,
for the most part, the
writers are always saying that we don't put in the background ponies. And that seems to be something that the fandom gets big into, is the background ponies.
Yeah.
That is all DHX. That is all the background people. Yeah, studio.
Yeah, like when I board, if there is a particular background pony I want in the finale, I was like, I gotta put Vinyl Scratch in here. Just
gotta put Vinyl.
That is my stupid, selfish. I need to have her in here because
I don't know why she was there, trying to be entertained by Fluttershy. But
I figure she would be the entertainer. But every now and then, you want to be entertained. Are you not entertained?
She's got the day off. So, if you really want a specific character, you would just draw her very specific. This is Vinyl Scratch. She stands out. Usually, I don't have time or care. Like, it's just. I just gotta get.
Well, when you've got so many scenes to do, you can only put so much effort.
You only have so much time. So it's usually the layout people who are the ones who eventually pick out because they actually deal with the flash files. Like, we don't have anything to do with that.
And so
that part.
And so times when we see Bon Bon and Lyra sitting together at a table, that is
most likely the layout people.
But I think that the fandom appreciates that more when we see these things.
The little nods,
those things, and we really appreciate. We love seeing Lyra and Bon Bon together. We really appreciate seeing background ponies with Pinky attached to the back of their heads and all sorts of things.
Every now and then, a derpy showing up.
Yeah, you can't. Yeah, yeah.
And so, but you know, you're able to add your own element to the story too,
mm-hmm.
and so it's a collaborative effort. And I know the writers are always very appreciative.
Yeah, for example, we were talking to Mitch Larson about the Trixie episode and saying like the whole Parasprite thing, where you know Twilight conjures Parasprites.
He was like,
I did not. Write that at all, but I'm glad that you know we work with such a great crew to be able to come up with that.
It's a good collaboration.
Yeah, and we were talking to Cindy Morrow about the Apple Family Reunion. She wrote Apple Family Reunion, and
yes.
That was when you bordered
on
that. And so, when you get a script and you're taking it to the story stage,
mm-hmm.
Are you looking at it for what can I add to it? Are you looking at what is your perspective?
Always, yeah. You always want to make it. You just want to take what you're given and punch it up. And
you don't just want to make it talking heads, you know, on the side.
To watch that,
right?
Even though ponies is a lot of talking, right. But I mean, you know, visually we try and keep it as interesting as we can,
right.
In the realm of the world. Apple Family Reunion, to me, I got the script and I was like, okay, this is kind of, like, compared to Too Many Pinkie Pies, it was a little
it's
bit.
It's a lot different than
that. I don't
want
to say boring, but it's just kind of, you know.
It was much more toned down, yeah.
Nice family-oriented episode, which
we also got to destroy the farm at the end.
I think I've destroyed the apple farm like 17 times since I've worked on this show.
You are the bane of the apple family.
I seem to be the one that always gets the apple.
You get to destroy the barn all the time.
I don't know why.
They're like, oh, we need to destroy the barn. Bring Sibsy in, the wrecking crew. We're going to call you the wrecking crew storyboard artist.
But yeah.
There's one particular scene in that I think that we can't not talk about. And that's the scene in the very beginning with the shooting stars. Tell us about that.
Well, I read the script and I found it kind of strange that it was called Apple Family Reunion and it was never touched on. And I understand you can't get to everything. And I was like, well, how come they never even mention it? And I know it's because I'm pretty sure Lauren had told us years ago that was kind of the idea and
right.
What I'm getting at. And
are we walking around the subject, or are we allowed to talk about it directly?
I guess so. Okay. I mean,
we'll play it safe.
I
think most people know what we're talking about.
It is what it is. And when I read it, I was like, there needs to be something. And when I read that one line that Granny Smith said about not having everyone, you know, maybe not everyone can make it next year, that's when it hit me. And I was like, that's where I'm going to do it. Like, that's where it'll fit. And I tried it, and I boarded it, and it was okay with Jason, the directors, and whatever. And then, again, everything has to go through approval. So I think it was subtle enough that, you know, like a tiny child would just...
Well, yeah.
It was subtle enough that I missed it.
It could be, you know, technically a heavy subject.
Well, I mean, like I said, that was one of the things that, you know, was amazing to me when I saw that, because, you know, on the first viewing, I was like, okay, maybe she's just thinking that, you know, maybe Granny won't be here next year or something like that. But then on multiple viewings, I was like, wait a minute, there's two of them.
Call back to it at the end.
There was a callback at the end. And so, yeah, it's one of those things that was subtle enough to almost miss on the first time. You can still see it and appreciate it. Yeah. But once you see it again, you really appreciate the depth of the thought that you put into this type of thing.
It just made me kind of sad. I was like, well.
And I think people appreciated it,
but
too,
it's nice
because
that the
characters
kind of have, you know, they're not all perfect. And
right.
They're not, they have flaws, and it just makes them more believable, at least to me.
It's a relatable experience that a lot of people go
like
through.
Like the whole Scootaloo not flying thing. Like, I think that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Like, you know, she's got this, you know, she can't fly.
Right.
She's dealing with it, but she's going on with her life. And
right.
She's finding another way around
it. And Applejack has her situation. She's moving on. She's not dwelling on it. She's moving on. But there's
doesn't define her, but it's a part of her.
But there's a few moments where you can reference it and see that if you acknowledge it almost, it makes her challenge even more visually and more entertaining, because you see and aware that it is a challenge.
Yeah, and you respect the character more for being so strong. So.
And then the finale. Let's move on. Let's talk about the finale.
Okay. Oh,
which
the
just
infamous
is
finale.
The infamous, wonderful finale. We all loved it. We really did.
I've been waiting on, we've been just sitting on that finale for like since last summer.
Now, is it a bigger challenge to animate a full-on musical versus there's the same amount of, there's more going on, so it's probably, I think Emmett Larson was saying that he was putting directions into what was going on, and then he put in parentheses dancing ponies in case, unless DHX thinks that is, will hate me.
Unless
Sipsy
can't handle it. Yeah, he specifically mentioned you.
Well, I didn't board it, so, but I never actually read that script. I was just on cleanup. I cleaned up like the first few songs from what I can remember, and I cleaned up near the end with when she was actually going through like the castle with the flutter.
So for the cleanup, that's just like timing and stuff like that.
It's basically taking the storyboard thumbnails and making them work and making them pretty.
Okay.
So,
yeah, blowing them up and yeah.
Yeah, so we can use it for animatics and timing.
And I think that if I don't say anything, the comments on YouTube are going to make reference to it. So, who do we have to thank for Derpy being in the finale?
I cannot say.
Okay.
It wasn't me. It wasn't me, though.
Okay.
A lot of people
think
it's
you can say no comment, and we'll not talk about Derpy
anymore.
No,
that's fine. It's a lot of people think it's me, but like I was saying, I've said online, like, I don't you have to, like I said, you have to really specify if you want a character, and I didn't even work on the parts that she was in, so.
Well, I know that everyone
Vinyl
really
Scratch
appreciated it.
Vinyl Scratch was me, for sure.
Okay, well, people really like that, too.
But Derpy,
yeah.
I don't, yeah, I can't say who did it or who.
Through process of elimination, we will find out this mystery.
And we will thank you, and we will be giving hugs. So, well, yeah. Thank you, Sibsy. This has been so much fun. It's always fun talking to you. And, you know.
And boring.
And, no, it's so much fun.
I was
fun.
Falling asleep.
It's so much fun. It's so much fun. You've been able to come to several conventions now. And, you know, you've worked on several programs. And this is the most exposure of any shows that you've worked on?
The Eds was kind of crazy. Because, I mean, I was on the Eds for 4.5 years. But nobody knew what I worked on in Canada. Whenever I went to like San Diego Comic Con, then everyone
right.
was like, what, you work on the Eds? And I was like, scared. Because usually the reaction...
Stop scaring Sibsy!
Usually the reaction is, what show is that? Like, no one's ever heard of it.
I've mentioned this a couple of times before, but it always amazes me the disparity between the Canadian and American entertainment. Like, you figured they would be similar target demographics.
Because it never aired in Canada. It only aired... Season one.
Right, but you would figure that they would air. I mean, if it's popular in America, logic would follow that
our
it would be popular in Canada.
Our humor is so alien.
Yeah, oh, yes. American humor, far too elite for your Canadian sensibilities.
I don't know why it wasn't aired in Canada. I just don't know if I'm at liberty to say why. It's not in my place.
Standards and practices and such as that.
Yeah, I don't want to burn any bridges.
That's
so.
Okay. That's okay. Well, we appreciate all the work that you did on the Eds. It was a fantastic show.
Yeah, it was a great show to work on.
And I think that the cool thing is there's a lot of people who were in the fandom of the Eds that are in the fandom of ponies. And
that's
so
cool.
It's sort of like...
Certainly a lot of the crew seems to go, yeah. Certainly a lot of this crew seems to be similar.
I like to imagine that it is. There's not true. I just, in my mind, there's this,
Eds,
you know, we're going to have a special side part at BronyCon that's going to be EdCon, and
EdCon.
We're just going to sit there, just me, hanging out,
just you, hopefully
singing,
Raven and
yes,
a few of us.
pretending that people care, but we'll be happy.
Yeah, that's all.
But well, thank you so much for
thank
coming
you for
here,
having
Sibsy.
Me.
Yeah, and after having worked on, well, actually, I want to see this now. You're in season 4, season 3, and everything. Mm-hmm. Have you seen changes in how the DHX comes out? Producing a show now that both that you've seen the progression of the characters themselves, as well as the Brony community, knowing that what you're going to do is going to have a huge audience.
We just do what we've always done. We haven't changed. We just want to go in, make the best show we can, and just hope people like it.
Well, we do love it. We like it a lot.
Because you can't please everyone, right? So you just have to go in and just, you know. We care. The crew cares about the show, which I think helps. It makes a big difference, right. You know.
When you're working on something that you care about, as opposed to I got to go in again.
The shows I've worked on where I'm just indifferent. I'm like, it's just a joke. Okay.
I did want to ask real quick though. I remember seeing one of your earlier tweets or a comment, I believe on.
Yeah.
Well, it was one of those things where it was like, you know, would you like to stay on if Pony ended up being one of the long runners? You know, if it ended up being 10, 15 seasons or something like that.
Well, it would be nice to have that kind
yeah.
of job security.
And I remember you. I think your reply was, well, I like drawing cheekbones, so. Is there something that you would like to do, like for as far as that?
I really like ponies, but I think like any artist, you eventually want to do something else. You want to flex your muscles, and you know every show is a different challenge for a different reason. I've been on ponies for a while now. I probably got another season or two left in me if there's another season or two left. So, I mean, I'm happy to stay.
Yeah.
But if another opportunity arises, you know, I wouldn't. Probably say no to it either.
No. Spread your wings and fly, you beautiful dove.
Spread your wings and fly. And we'll
something like that.
spread your wings and fly. Oh, we need to get Mitch Larson here for that one.
Yeah!
I missed something.
That's... Thank you so much.
No worries.
It's always great to see you. And it's always great to see
always
Plank
to see
again.
Plank,
do you have any questions? No, you're in trouble. You were mean to Sam, so we're not going to have
was
you.
Was he really?
Yeah, he was very mean. We had to keep him
jerk.
Back. He is a jerk. He always gets really wooden in front of the camera, though, and so he you know. No, we're done.
We're done.
And so, yeah, real quick, if you want to say anything to the bronies out there that love your work and like to see more.
Thank you for liking my work. It's overwhelming. I don't know. I mean... I've always had people, you know me for my work, but the Brony community is just so much larger scale, so it's overwhelming, and you know, for the most part, it's been positive. And I just want to say thanks to all the people who have supported me and have gotten to know me personally and take the time to say hello, and because that's what I'm here for. So,
well, thank you so much for coming here. It's been wonderful talking to you. And once again, I'm Joe Stevens.
I am LTT Moose.
And this has been the Equestrian Inquirer for Everfree Northwest, Everfree Network.
You are terrible at this, my friend.
I know I am.
I'm sorry. I'm going solo after this.
They need to change that. They need to change that name. Everfree Network at Las Pegasus Unicon.
Class is back.
Class is in session, and it's now out.